With COP27 well underway in Egypt and a new candidate for the Hamilton by-election, there's lots to discuss, so let's get into it. Morena, Mr. Luxon, how are you doing?
Morning, Matty. How are you going?
I'm very well, thank you. With COP27, you know, well underway, obviously this is a big talking point at the moment. How much does climate change concern you? How high does that rank in your list of things to worry about?
Oh, look, I mean, the National Party is deeply, deeply committed to our net zero goals for 2050. We've been supportive of the government's emissions reductions budgets. We're very committed to the ends. The means by which we do it will be slightly different, but it's incredibly important, Matty.
That's a slightly different sentiment to the previous national government. I was reading some of John Key's previous comments on climate change when he was leader, and he said that New Zealand doesn't need to be and shouldn't be a leader in climate change, that it was a question of whether it was worth the cost of being a global leader. Do you agree with that sentiment, or do you think we can be a global leader in climate change?
Well, it's not really about whether we are a global leader or not. It's actually about making sure that we're doing and meeting our commitments and playing our part and doing everything we can to reduce emissions here in New Zealand and doing so in a sensible way, a pragmatic way, an evidence-based way. And that's why, you know, as a National Party under my leadership, we are deeply committed to delivering net zero 2050. I drove a lot of that in my old life in a business sense. I'm really committed to it and to making sure that we do so sustainably. So, you know, that is without doubt the National Party is deeply committed to those goals. We may deliver ends differently from the government to hit those goals.
Yeah, let's talk about some of that, because the biggest question is, of course, has always been, how do we tackle this? How do we get this right? And the biggest, boldest plan from the government at the moment is to get farmers to pay for their emissions starting in 2025, which you stand in the way of. So why do you do that? Why do you stand in the way of a big, bold plan like that?
Well, there was a big, bold plan, Matty. It was an industry-developed solution, which the whole sector had got consensus around, or was starting to build consensus around. The government then went on and actually moved it on and changed it dramatically. You know, you cannot go and offload one-fifth of your beef and lamb industry within 7 years, move those emissions off overseas to less carbon-efficient or emission-efficient farms and countries, and make global emissions even worse. And on the other hand, you can't actually say to farmers, we're going to charge you the full price of your emissions, but not actually give you the credits for all the good things that you're doing. So there were some really big challenges what the government's got on the table, and it's a real shame because there was industry consensus building for an acknowledgement of a challenge that we have to rise to, agricultural emissions, and the government's broken that consensus within the sector.
Although James Shaw says that the government's plan is directly related to the emissions pricing based on the modelling and the system put forward by the sector partnership.
I can tell you, Matty, I've met with all of the sector CEOs. I meet with two or three farmer groups on the farm each and every week. You know, last week I was in Waipukurau, I was in Dannevirke, I've been in Waimate, I've been in Balclutha, talking to farmers on the ground, as well as the CEOs of those peak body groups. What the government's proposing and what they propose are very different schemes.
Although I wonder if therein lies the problem, because National has by and large been the party that farmers have turned to for support, right? I saw you recently say we need to back our farmers like we back the All Blacks.
We do.
And I wonder if that poses a problem though, because can you be the party that backs the farmers like you back the All Blacks and be the party that seriously tackles climate change?
Absolutely, Matty, and we need to change our mindset from saying farmers are villains. We have the best farmers in the world. They're the most efficient, emissions-efficient farmers in the world. We should back them. We should back New Zealanders to develop the solutions for the world around agricultural emissions. It's really hard because there's no easy silver bullets there, but by investing in agricultural R&D, I've been and visited a lot of the research program at, say, Lincoln University. You look at what's happening with the breeding of animals and how we're getting better and better to be able to generate animals that are lighter, that have more productivity. You know, they're fantastic achievements. It's incredible what's going on inside the sector. There's a lot of smart young people driving a lot of innovation in it, and that's the answer as we go forward. But the answer is not to go destroy people's livelihoods in the way that the government has brutally come down to in the last few weeks.
Although it's a real sticking point, because as you say, farmers will tell you that they are working really hard and really fast to make significant changes on their farms. But climate activists will say we are not going nearly fast enough, especially considering nearly half of New Zealand's greenhouse gas emissions come from agriculture. So where is it? Who's got it right? Are farmers acting fast enough, or do we need to move quicker?
Well, you want to take the farming community with you. That the farming community understands they've got to change. I just encourage you, Maddie, get out on a farm and actually see it and showcase it to the broader New Zealand people.
Oh, we
Farmers
do.
Are farming differently from 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 15 years ago. There's amazing things happening on farm. And so we need to back our farmers rather than vilify them, which is, I think, what's been happening with this government, and actually make sure that we actually develop a solution that actually deals with agricultural emissions, ultimately prices those emissions, but does so in a way that we can pace it and do it in the right way.
Look, I don't know, though, that people are trying to vilify farmers. I think that it just comes down to the fact that these conversations continue to happen about the fact that globally we are not moving fast enough on climate change. And here in New Zealand, agricultural emissions, as I said, are nearly half of our greenhouse gas emissions in this country. So it's just about finding the right solutions to move quick enough. And are we moving quick enough, do you think?
Well, Matty, there's more to do, and we're not moving quick enough. We've got a Labor government that comes in with a big bumper sticker, you know, but talking big about climate change. We actually have gone and knocked off oil and gas in particular. We now import three times as much coal as we did in any year of a national government, and actually our emissions have got worse. And so we're not making progress. You're right about that. But what we do need to do on agricultural emissions is the sector is up for it. They understand the changes that are coming their way over the next 20 to 30 years. They want to evolve. They had a proposal. It was a stretching one. It still required a lot of consensus to be built around it. And the government went and blew it all up by pushing it way too far and destroying people's livelihoods. That's not
all. Although you say we're not moving fast enough, and then you say the government's pushing things too far. It feels like we actually need to be pushing things as far as they can possibly go if we are going to move fast enough.
Yeah, well, the point is we need to be able to get in and actually make some of the tools work, like the ETS scheme, like the investments in research and development we need in agriculture, like reform planning so that we can actually get renewable energy put together faster for all New Zealanders. So there's a lot of work for us to do. But at the moment, Maddie, go look at the emissions reduction plan. Half of it was we're going to write a strategy, we're going to have a delegation, we're going to have a hui, we're going to discuss this stuff. A lot of talk, no action.
Speaking of talk, you were in Taranaki recently and you pledged to bring back a gas exploration in Taranaki. I was reading some of the report from the International Energy Agency that made it very clear that relying on fossil fuel gas as a transition fuel is not an option anymore. So it just seems like there's contradictions between you feeling like you want to move fast enough, that you want to be the party for climate change, and then standing in the way of meaningful change.
But Maddie, let's look at that issue, right? The government went and knocked off the gas sector in New Zealand overnight. As a result, it ended up having to actually import in bucket loads, a million tonnes of Indonesian coal to New Zealand, almost three times as much as we've imported in any given year under the national government. And now we have worse emissions. So I'm trying to be really pragmatic about that to say, look, in dry years, New Zealand needs to be able to have energy security. And as a result, we need gas for a few more decades as we make that transition. Gas is imperfect, I get it, it's not perfect, but it's got half the emissions profile of coal. So the question is, I'm trying to take you through an worked example, because it's all very well sitting at the 40,000 foot level making some grand statements, but you actually have to get these things really granular and get to the root cause and work your way through the challenge and the problem. And so we need gas to be able to give us energy security. It's a lot better than coal, and ultimately over the long term, yes, we have to be able to move through to be able to build renewable energy across New Zealand, which we've done incredibly well, already the world's leading proponents of it.